black month for the country, but we've seen the death of four VIPs in a span, a very short time. Your thoughts, first of all, to the family and friends of the four that we lost.
Yeah, first of all, you know, I would like to send my condolences to the families of our leaders. You know, it's really painful to lose our leaders in such a time of 1 or 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. To me, I think it has been going on now for more than 10, 15 years. If you go back to what is happening, the month of July, August, and September has been a very, very bad month for this nation. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to make sure that we unite together on whatever is happening in this nation, and bring back down the political tension which is going on right now in this nation.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and maybe just to a few words for in remembrance of those who we lost. The first one at the end of June, that is the 30th of June, was Senator Gigi Kariuki. Yesterday, President Uhuru Kenyatta led his burial at his home. Havi, maybe your thoughts on the legacy that Gigi Kariuki left behind.
Senator Gigi Kariuki is reputed to be one of the youngest entrants into elective politics. He's said to have been elected Member of Parliament at the tender age of 22, and he rose through the ranks of his political career and leadership until the time of his demise. I think there is much to be remembered about him, and there is much to be learned on how to progress in one's political career. Mm-hmm. I think he goes with a lot of memories for many Kenyans.
Right, right. Yes. And soon after that, of course, was the late Joseph Nkaiseria. Death that definitely shocked many Kenyans. President Uhuru Kenyatta will be leading his burial at his home in Ilbisil in Kajiado today. Tommy, your thoughts, first of all, on the legacy. A lot has been said on the legacy that Nkaiseria left behind.
He said he was a wonderful man. He was a career general, and he took over from a very bad situation, and he handled it well. It's unfortunate the way he passed away so soon, but what I don't like is the conspiracy theories behind his death.
Right.
People have strokes, it happens. Mm-hmm. There's no forewarning, there's no foreshadowing of this coming. So let's rest his peace and honor his memory.
Mm-hmm. And of course, I mean, it's the same thing Ndolo was bringing up, saying, you know, the months of July, August, and September, going back in the years, have been quite shocking for Kenyans. But Tanui, after that, we also had very recently, this is just yesterday, Bethwel Kiplagat, who is the fourth leader the Kenyans have lost this month. And many say that a lot of secrets will be going down with him. He'll mostly be remembered for chairing the TJRC. Your thoughts on the legacy he leaves behind?
Sure, let me say, I want to send my message of condolences to the family, both to all the four senior leaders we lost. And I want to say I remember Kiplangat being a very senior citizen of this country. He contributed a lot, and especially when it during the peace meetings, he chaired the South Sudan peace meeting, and he also chaired the TJRC here in Kenya. Mm-hmm. And we know him to have been a very good ambassador, and I would want to say we've lost one of the senior most citizens of this country.
Mm-hmm. Yes. All right, and of course, taking a look at page 5 of the paper there, Wagala killings clouded envoy's tenure at TJRC. So he's been linked to the 1984 Wagala killings, which saw hundreds lose their lives. And Ndolo, your thoughts, first of all, on this TJRC report, because it's been brought to the forefront now. We've seen it take center stage, especially in the campaign trail, with the NASA leader Raila Odinga saying it will be the first thing they implement should they clinch the August 8th elections. Your thoughts on how important it is to implement this report?
Well, I think it's very important for whatever happened during the Ogara instance. And I agree with the papers which have come out with this story. But however, you know, it has passed, and we need to think a lot about what happened actually. but our leaders who have gone past that incidents, we need to heal the way we came out with the that time when people were thinking about our nation in a very bad situation. But Ambassador Kiplagat, to me, I think he tried his best at that time, mm-hmm. according to what was happening. And people can write or can think maybe he was part of it. However, he was proved not guilty about it.
Mm-hmm.
So let us think about this nation. Let us come back and see how, where are we going? Because everybody, at least one day, you'll also die.
Mm-hmm. And leave something behind.
Yeah,
right, we'll come back to the matter of the TJRC report.
Yeah.
But let's now move on to something that has been making headlines this week, and that is the political intolerance that has been seen across the country. So this began, first of all, with Ruto being heckled, Deputy President William Ruto being heckled in Kisumu. That later followed, Raila Odinga later on being heckled in regions of Kiambu. He was also heckled in areas of Githurai, and we've seen leaders from across the political divide come out and condemn this new wave of political intolerance. But Havi, what precedence do you think this sets now, just about 22 days to the election?
It is a precursor to what many people may not want to talk about, but it is the reality. I think the Kenyan nation is so polarized, it may be said to be divided right in the middle between two camps. And look, if you see what happened in Kisumu, you could not explain, because at one point in time, the crowds were very happy to see the president. They were very happy to listen to what he said. But when the deputy president took the mic and attempted to speak to the people, they were not happy. Much as people may want to sugarcoat this issue as one reduced to the level of the crowd, I think also the leaders shoulder a measure of responsibility mm-hmm. to what happens. For instance, if one particular leader has made his habit to be abusing the other leader, and you go to the other leader's home turf, these are things that you're likely to expect. And it now becomes quite clear that this deterioration is not one that has originated from beneath. I think it's one that has started from the top. And it is the responsibility of the top leaders to ensure that their manner of speech, in fact, they have an obligation to sift and ensure that the information that they disseminate to mm-hmm. the public is one that will not promote civil strife. I think the leaders have to blame entirely.
Right. Tommy, I don't know if you agree with that this was completely the onus of the leaders and the precedents that they set.
Yes, I agree. Leaders have some responsibility to bear, because they know better than their electorate. And this notion of trying to activate your voters, like the base voters, the people who appeal to this kind of notion, if that's the message it takes for them to, for you to get them out and look active, mm-hmm. it's not right. You need to be able to respect other people's opinions, and not, why are you going to somebody else's, why are you going to heckle other people? Don't go. If that's not the leader you want to support, don't go to that rally.
Mm-hmm.
Go to your leader's rally.
Right.
Don't go cause problems. Just let them have their constitutional right to assemble and disseminate their ideas.
Mm-hmm. And of course, there's been allegations that have not been confirmed yet that these hecklers were paid, these hecklers were directed by leaders of several or different political parties. Mm-hmm. There's been allegations that political parties are funding their own hecklers so they can lay blame to the opposition. But are these the kind of blame games we should be engaging in now, Tanui? 22 days to the general elections,
we've
been preaching peace left, right, and center.
Not really, Michelle. I would want to say, as said by my friends, that it is indeed unfortunate that we are still engaging in such in such a way at this age. Because I look at it this way, that there are people who are supposed to, if it doesn't end as soon as possible, it might escalate to a different level. Now, when I look at this, the cause of all these problems are the top politicians. And it will only be the same three or four people, the top politicians, to end who can end, bring this to an end. Mm-hmm. When I look at it, the current politicians are zoning areas. Zoning is becoming a very serious problem, Michelle. When you say this is my person, this is my region, this is where I'm supposed to have my votes, it brings problems. Mm-hmm. So I want to say yes. On one point, it's true that these hecklers are actually bought because they are buried. When you look at the rallies, the people attending rallies, like in Kiambu, when Raila was in Kiambu, there were so many people. When he went to Thika, there were so many people. When Uhuru went to Kisumu, there were so many people. I want to believe that these people are paid to attend, and they are the same people who are buried actually to heckle other leaders. So these should actually be brought to an end as soon as possible.
Right. Ndolo, I don't know if you agree with your counterparts that the top leaders are to blame for this. And even as you give your comments, IBC Chair Fula Chebukati did say that action will be taken against the culprits of electoral offences, especially the heckling that we saw this past week. Are you confident in the IBC to rain down all culprits of electoral offences?
Well, first of all, I think I would agree on what my colleagues have said about the top leaders. You can see today President Uhuru and former Prime Minister Raila Odinga have condemned the incidents. To me, I'll blame those people who follow those top leaders. They want to make sure that they want to show to the other part of the world or to the country that we are in charge in this region. Mm-hmm. You can see at Kisumu what happened. Those hecklers were wearing Jubilee t-shirts. Why? And after that, they were chanting NASA. So you can see part of it is those leaders behind. They want to please some of the top leaders. And that's why we have a lot of problems. These leaders who are looking for positions behind the top leaders are the ones who, in fact, should be blamed. And they have to be very careful. Because to me, right now, if I will ask the top leaders, President Uhuru and former Prime Minister Raila Odinga, to have even a cup of tea right now, and so that the tension also can be, they can be seen that they are leaders. This is the nation. On the 8th, it will come and go. Okay. What about the country? Mm-hmm. So they should have a cup of tea right now, so that the nation can see that things are okay. And we don't have to. Mm-hmm.
And
I mean,
we've been seeing a lot of that peace prayers. They've been doing joint peace prayers as well. But Havi, going by what Chebukati says, that action will be taken against culprits of election offences. How easy, as per the law, is it for IBC to rain down on culprits of election offences? I mean, it would be a lot easier if we were talking of top leaders. But when we're talking of the crowd and the rowdy crowd, then how does IBC even begin?
IBC has a very big problem because IBC's net is fond of catching small fish, the omena. It cannot catch the buta. And let's be practical. If you look at across the divide, you will hear one set of politicians calling the other set ule jamaa vitenda wili, ule mganga, ule mwendazimu, and the other set calling the other set ule mwizi, ule mlevi. Now, if Chebukati really means business, all he needs to do is to summon Honorable Raila Odinga and summon President Uhuru Kenyatta and summon Ruto. And tell them, look, you're leaders, you can't be speaking this nonsense. In all fairness, this is nonsense. You can't be calling somebody ule jamaa vitenda wili. You can't be calling a leader of a country ule jamaa mlevi. And let's give credit a little bit to Raila. I've not heard Raila mention his opponents in very bad terms. Perhaps some of his junior lieutenants do so. But to the extent that this cannot be contained, then IBC's lamentations will just be that lamentation. Mm-hmm. I think it will be a lot of noise. It will not achieve anything.
Right.
Much.
And I mean, Tommy, we keep talking about an interagency approach to ensure peace ahead of the elections. And among these agencies is the Independent Electoral and Boundaries Commission. The NCIC also comes in very handy in terms of this. But is this 22 days to the general election? Are you getting that feel of this interagency approach really maintaining peace and curbing hate speech before the elections?
As far as hate speech is concerned, I think they lost the battle a long time ago. We've seen people get acquitted when they've been on TV propagating hate speech. I won't mention names, but you know yourselves. So I think that fight has been lost. But in the future, and the next 22 days going forward, like Honorable Ndolo here suggested, they can have a cup of tea and cool down the political tension.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, this is something that has been going on in the country for a while, national prayers, peace prayers. Mm. And there's been a conversation going around on Twitter as to are our leaders trying to change the narrative. Why are they asking Kenyans to be peaceful? What is the recipe for peace? Now, many say there can be no peace without justice. Some have pointed out to our national anthem, which is a prayer, which says, let peace be our justice, a shield and defender. Haki iwe ngao na mlinzi. It doesn't say peace. It says justice. So, Tanui, in terms of beginning with you, as our leaders preach peace ahead of the general elections, are they doing enough to ensure that there is justice? Justice in terms of credibility of the electoral process, justice in terms of credibility of the court processes. Are we seeing that?
They are not doing enough. They are not doing enough because we've not seen anyone prosecuted on this. And I want to say if it is good to pray for the country. In fact, it's the right way forward. But I want to say the solution to this still remains to be with the key principals, the president, the deputy president, the leader of NASA, Raila Odinga, and Mudavadi. Let me put it this way. I know the NCIC and IEBC do not have powers to prosecute. Prosecution now can only be done by the police. Mm-hmm. And prosecution as at now is not enough. I also want to say prosecution as at now is not enough. But then it's good to approach these people, or it's good to approach the electorate in a sober manner. So it's as well good to pray. But then we need a different approach.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Ndolo, your thoughts on this? I mean, we keep preaching peace and justice, but are we seeing justice being upheld in this electoral process?
Mm. Michelle, I think justice in this nation, I'm not a lawyer, but you can see for the past many years, a common man in this nation suffers a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And Tanui has put it very right that the top leaders, not only the top leaders, but those who have it in this nation, carry the day everywhere. That's mm-hmm. why for us to have justice, you have to start first from the common man.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we don't have justice on whoever is down there, and we just think about somebody who's at the top, then we'll be having a lot of... We can have prayers every day. We can have everything that we think about. But is the justice in this country being practiced according to how it is?
Mm-hmm.
Because somebody who's down there have always a problem about justice. And the people who control everything we have, that's what I'm saying, the two sides, they have it and they don't have it. We still have that. The cap is very wide, mm-hmm, Michelle, mm-hmm. Very wide.
And so it is something, of course, that needs to be bridged.
Yes.
But Havi, look, just taking a, maybe like draw your attention to page 15 of the Standard newspaper here. And it says, this is an opinion poll by Barack Muluka, and he says, it is futile to call for a peaceful poll while mocking the courts. And this, of course, takes us back to when the ruling for the ballot printing tender for the presidential ballot papers was given by the court. We saw a lot of back and forth, many terming it an attack on the judiciary itself, especially by the executive. Havi, you know, your thoughts on this article, first of all, and whether the courts have maintained the independence in this whole furor.
I think of all the writers, Barack Mluka writes with a lot of intelligence and order, and there's nothing that we can say but to agree with what he says. And the reasons are numerous. You remember when Kofi Annan was last here, he told Kenyans, please do not compromise your quest for justice mm-hmm. on the altar of the claim of peace. Because if you suspend your quest for justice, for peace, the peace will prevail just for an interim period. And the more reason as to why, those who are saying that we need prayers for peace have an obligation to tell Kenyans, what is it that they are saying that we do not see? Under what circumstances can there be a demand for peace unless, of course, one has prepared for war? Mm-hmm. To the extent that elections are a two-tier process, both legal and political, it is incumbent upon the institution that has the oversight of this exercise, being the IBC, to ensure that not only is it fair, but is also seen to have been fair. Mm-hmm. And the past history does not demonstrate any fidelity on the part of the IBC whatsoever. So to that extent, therefore, IBC has a big obligation. And this is not an obligation that can be transferred to the players, because the players are contestants. It cannot be expected of them, irrespective of how much direction you give them. They want to win by all means. Mm-hmm. So the responsibility here completely rests on the shoulder of the IBC.
Right.
Let us have a just election. We don't need a peaceful election. Peace is always there, but we need a just election. Mm-hmm. If there is justice, then peace will prevail.
Peace will prevail. Now, yes. Many have said, you know, we're being too hard as a country on the IBC. It is a new team that just came in the other day. We all understand the circumstances they came in through. So in terms of whether we are creating that environment for IBC to prosper and deliver a credible election, let's go to page 25 of the Standard. IBC says court order may abort polls. So this is with regard to the court hearing yesterday. As to the fate of the presidential printing of ballot papers. And so the argument that was given by the IBC as well as Attorney General Givu Muigai was that they may not be able to deliver a polls by the 8th of August if they have to tender afresh the printing of ballot papers. And you know, with backing from the Attorney General, they're saying, while it is impossible, it is also a constitutional crisis if we postpone the presidential polls. So, Tommy, this seemingly a lot getting lost here in the legal gaps and the legal jargon that the lawyers are speaking about. But what situation is a country looking at now? Time is moving. It's 22 days to go. IBC still says it is not enough time for them to print those papers.
Michelle, let me start by exonerating Catholic University. You introduced me as a lecturer there.
Right.
I'm not a lecturer there, but that's where I studied my law.
Mm-hmm.
All right. But yes, it does pose a constitutional crisis because it's a constitutional mandated date that the election happened on the 8th of August. Now, if there's a delay, it will create a constitutional crisis. And honestly, I don't know how to go about it because this is something we've never been through before. This mm-hmm. will be a first. I'm not too familiar with the tendering process, but I still think it is possible for it to get done ahead of time, because only the presidential ballot papers are in question here.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe somebody else with better knowledge can tell us how that process will go forward. And also, we don't know what the Court of Appeal ruling is going to be.
Right.
Yes.
So we'll come back to Havi for that, especially for the legal interpretation. But Tanui, earlier on, even IBC had said they would need about eight days to print the presidential ballot papers. Mm-hmm. But now they're saying even with 20-something days, too, it might just be impossible considering the entire tendering process and then the print process.
Yeah.
Your thoughts on what solution the country really has? IBC met presidential candidates the other day. They did not reach a consensus.
Yeah, yeah.
What really can the country do about this?
Michelle, at the end of the day, we have to elect our leaders on 8th. It's a constitutional mandate, as said by my friend here. But then I look at it as something that is workable. We have three, as said by him, it is hard for them to go through the open tender process, they can still go for a single sourcing process, mm-hmm. in which they may not take long to identify a specific printing firm. Mm-hmm. If that is not the case, they can also they can opt to go for a restricted tender, and they pick a specific company for that matter. That can be done within a few days. When I look at it now, we have about 23 days to go, mm-hmm. or something like that. If it's done as soon as possible, I'm certain we will
It might happen. So 22 days. Havi, what is getting lost in the legal interpretation? Why is IBC saying this might be impossible?
First, I think we need to address it from an eliminative point of view. There's only one option that is now available for the IBC, irrespective of what the court decides on Thursday, and I think that would be direct procurement. So that if the court upholds the Al-Ghuraya contract, mm-hmm. then they will go on. If the court agrees with the High Court, then they need to do direct procurement. Mm-hmm. But what was the source of the problem in the beginning? The source of the problem was, insofar as it relates to the presidential ballot papers, Al-Ghuraya was perceived to have been tainted on account of alleged relationships between its owners and certain elements in the Jubilee administration. The High Court found for a fact that was not substantiated. Mm. Much of the High Court found as much, there is that perception in the public that, look, as the court of the public opinion, there could have been merits on that. And to that extent, therefore, the High Court said, fine, whereas there appear to be no evidence of any taint, but we seem to see the absence of public participation. In my view, the time that is now left is sufficient for IBC to print the ballot papers mm-hmm. through anybody, either be it Al-Ghuraya if that contract is upheld, or through any other individual mm-hmm. who may be procured directly. I don't think there will be a crisis, and whosoever continues with this song that there's a constitutional crisis, I think this crisis just exists in their own version. We're not seeing the crisis. Mm-hmm. For a fact, an election will be conducted on the 8th of August. What IBC needs to do is to leverage and abridge the time, ensure that what has to be done is done within the period that has to be done. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it will end up leaving one set of these contestants claiming the election will not be postponed, and another one saying, who has asked for the election to be postponed?
Right.
And in reality, none of these parties have insisted that the election be postponed. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, many have argued, because we do not know the ruling of the court yet, mm-hmm. but especially those from the opposition have argued that should the court then reverse or fail to uphold the earlier ruling, then they will be letting the IBC breach the constitution in terms of flouting the issues of public participation. Is that something that could further complicate the situation legally?
Not really. I remember listening to the CEO of NASA, Norman Magai. He said about 3 days ago, they will abide by the outcome of the Court of Appeal. Mm-hmm. If the Court of Appeal says, let Al-Ghuraya print the presidential ballot boxes, so ballot paper, so be it. I don't think there will be a catastrophe.
Right. Yes. Ndolo, let me finish with you before you take a short commercial break. Your thoughts on this IBC printing issue? Many have termed it an issue of trust. You know, the capacity is there. You know, we can print them locally, but many just don't trust each other, especially politically.
Mm-hmm. Well, Michelle, I'll go back again and say, this country is ours. And this issue of printing didn't start now, maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. I think it started about 2 years or 3 years. If you look at what Abu Duba, the presidential candidate, said, mm-hmm. why are we just, I mean, going on about printing of the tender? If really we mean good for this nation, there must be something that we need to sit down and say, no, this is our nation. If really whoever did, if there was something which happened, or if you suspect anything, why don't we sit down, all of us? Mm-hmm. The way Tanu said, the two leaders are the ones now who are responsible to have proper and good election for this country.
All right, gentlemen, let me pause it there. It is now 37 minutes past the hour. You're watching Weekend Express. We'll have to take a short break now, but do stay with us. We'll be back with the conversation as we take a look at more top stories making headlines this week.